Hi. So yeah, I've got this secret government agency type thing after me because, well, I made something. A time machine that can go back in time. You see, travelling into the future, well, that's kind of easy, relatively speaking. The closer you get towards the speed of light, the slower time goes, or if you stood next to something with a huge amount of mass. So either jump on a really fast rocket or stand next to a black hole, return to Earth, and you'll have aged less than the people that you left behind. Selfishly, I might add, but effectively making you a time traveller. And these aren't just theories, we've proved it time and time again with experiments, and the equations are used in everyday technology, including GPS. But travelling back in time, well, there's only theories and no way of proving them until now. What a complete brick. I'm on it, like a car bonnet. This is what they're after. I call it the backup time transporter gun. I wonder what the acronym is for that. Oh well, no time. How many times are we going to play these games, Mr. Burgess? How does it work?
Well, first off, it's Burgess, and secondly, why don't I give you the finger?
You naughty man.
and if you could give me my phone call, that would be great, because my mum gets really worried if I don't let her know where I am.
What use is a phone call
if your mum isn't home? I know, it used to drive me nuts, but she's got a mobile now. And got cheap SIM-only deal too, so low rates.
How does it work?
Well, I gave my old phone, so she only needed a SIM card.
The device!
Oh, sorry. I thought you meant...
Is it a Tipler cylinder?
A what? A Tipler cylinder? In 1974, an American physicist and astronomer, Frank Tipler, came up with a pretty unusual solution for time travel. A f-off massive cylinder.
You see, huge masses, like planets, stars, and black holes, they warp space-time.
The larger the mass, the more space-time is warped, and the slower time goes, from an observer's point of view at least.
He imagined a technology that would warp space-time so much that would actually bend back on itself, creating something called a closed time-like curve, a loop that, in theory, could be traversed to travel back in time.
So in Tipler's time travel solution, all you'd need to do is take something as massive as, say, a black hole, roll it into an unimaginably dense cylinder, and rotate it at least a few billion revolutions per minute. And the rotation is key. By doing so, it drags space-time along with it, just like my spoon in this cup of tea. This, coupled with the huge distortions around the super-dense matter, is what creates those closed time-like curves, in theory. Once the cylinder is rotating fast enough, a spaceship could follow a precise spiral route around it and travel thousands or maybe even billions of years into the past, and maybe even several galaxies away.
But guess what? There's a problem. Stephen Hawking proved that this wouldn't work with a finite cylinder like this, one with ends. Hawking calculated that it would need to be infinitely long, unless you had something called negative energy to boost it up. But no one knows if negative energy even exists. It's not even predicted by our current model of the universe. It's just a mathematical add-on, something invented purely to make things like Tipler cylinders seem more achievable.
So if the question is, have I managed to squeeze an infinitely long swirling cylinder with the mass of a black hole into this tiny plastic container? Well,
No.
It's not a Tipler cylinder?
No, I just said no. Maybe if you took your thing out your ear and stopped listening to ABBA, then you would have heard me the first time.
It's not for listening. It's for contacting other agents, Mr. Burgers.
Dancing queen, feel that beat on the tambourine, oh yeah.
Does it make wormholes?
Wormholes?
Yes, wormholes. You motherfucker.
How do you get this far without knowing how wormholes work?
It's not that funny, Mr. Burgers. Not many people know how they work.
Yeah, all right.
Despite how ridiculous it sounds that there might be tunnels connecting different places in space and time, wormholes, also known as Einstein-Rosen bridges, were dreamt up by some ruddy clever chaps, Albert Einstein and Nathan Rosen. So you can pretty much guarantee that there's something to it.
So why haven't we found any yet? Well, it might be because they're really, really small, like much, much smaller than atoms. Or it might be because they're so unstable that even photons entering them would cause them to collapse and vanish the instant that they were created. Or it might be that we haven't found any wormholes yet because they're in disguise.
You see, there's a fairly big problem with black holes. They gobble up everything that crosses their path, even light. But where does all that stuff go? Well, according to Einstein, that stuff is destroyed. But quantum mechanics says that all matter boils down to data, and that data cannot be destroyed. This led Stephen Hawking to theorize that this data isn't destroyed, but might exist as holograms, swirling around the edge of black holes. However, a more recent theory suggests that they are both wrong, and that the data is actually transported to another part of the universe. Black holes might actually be wormholes. But instead of waiting to find out, why don't we just build a wormhole? Well, no one really knows how. All we know is that it would take a spectacular amount of energy, like the amount of energy created from building a particle collider the size of the solar system and smashing atoms together with such force that it might tear a hole in space-time. Or from manipulating and transporting stars, yes, entire stars, into some giant spinning ring that might slowly open up a wormhole. And then there's the problem of keeping these incredibly unstable wormholes open. And so once again, we'll need a dash of that negative energy. Remember? That stuff that might not even exist?
But look, this is boring. Let's imagine for a second that none of these things were out of our reach, or just plain batshit crazy, and that we could create a wormhole that humans could traverse.
To travel back in time, all we'd need to do is leave one end of the wormhole here on Earth and transport the other end, at close to the speed of light, to another part of the universe. The time dilation effect of traveling close to the speed of light would cause time to run much slower relative to the wormhole entrance back on Earth. Send a spaceship through the entrance and it would travel into the future, but go the other way and you would travel back into the past. The faster you went and the further you took the wormhole, the more the time dilation effect and the more spread out either end of the wormhole would be in time. But you know, good luck with all that. No, not wormhole.
Please, Mr. Burgers, do not muck me.
Yeah, it's Burgess, but yeah, you're right, actually. I'm sorry, I just get a little bit nervous when I've been kidnapped by a government agent and interrogated. I shouldn't have taken it out on you.
Well, Mr. Burgers, Burgess, I appreciate that. I have been going through some stuff at home, and ever since Special Agent Sparkles died, I just haven't been myself. If it's not a Tipler cylinder,
and it's not a wormhole machine,
then it must be lasers.
Lasers. No, but...
By using something like a hugely upscaled version of a ring laser, a device used in modern air and spacecraft to aid GPS,
it might be possible to use light to twist space-time and create those closed time-like curves and send stuff back in time.
Or at least, that's what theoretical physicist Professor Ron Mallet thinks.
Like a plot from a bad science fiction movie, after his father died at the age of only 33, Ron set about learning physics with the dream of one day creating a time machine to save his father's life. Professor Mallet has drawn up plans for an actual time machine, and his concept was inspired by a book he read at age 12 about Einstein's equations. You see, Einstein showed that large masses like planets, stars, and black holes warp space-time and create gravity. The closer you are to the center of that mass, the slower time goes. Isaac Newton said that the only thing that can create gravity is matter, but Einstein thought otherwise. In his theory of general relativity, he says that light can also create gravity. So if gravity can affect time, and light can create gravity, then light can affect time. The light emitted in the ring laser time machine would, in theory, spin and warp space within it. And because space and time are interwoven, when you spin space, you spin time. And voila! You have a closed time-like curve, a passage into the past. But there's always a but.
Professor Mallet has been unable to test out his theory, not only because of funding problems, but also because, and by his own admission, the energy required to test it would be vast, like the entire output of a star, vast. And so, like Tipler cylinders and wormholes, we're thrown back into the world of science fiction.
So, yeah, not lasers.
I'm starting to think that this isn't a time machine at all.
Yeah, bingo.
Then what? Is it?
It's a vacuum. It says on the side. I mean, it was a time gun back at the beginning when I made that wormhole, but now it's a vacuum. It's a glitch.
A glitch?
A glitch, yeah. In the sim.
Simulation?
You're not real. I'm not real. None of this is real.
I assure you, Mr. Burgers, I am very...
For f***ing sake, it's Burgess.
Burgers? Burgess. Cheeseburger.
Burgess.
Cheeseburgess.
No cheese, just Burgess.
Burger. Did you bring that in here?
Shh. Look again. See? Glitch.
All I see is a dead cat.
So yeah, confusing, I know, but plot twists usually are, so stay with me.
You see, I think that this might be the only way that we ever get to time travel. As upsetting as it sounds, I think that one day some of us might live out our entire lives in computer simulations, kind of like the Matrix, although hopefully voluntary. And just like in any computer simulation, a user could potentially go back and visit any point in that simulation's past. You'd be like a time traveler in your own digital universe, or even a shared one. You could go back and change things, create new simulation timelines, or live in multiple simulated parallel universes, assuming your brain didn't melt. And if that doesn't bake your noodle, then I don't know what will. As for real time travel, just not convinced. Sorry, don't think it's ever gonna happen. Cue my future self coming back to slap me in the face. But what do you think? Do you think that we'll ever figure out traveling back in time? Or do you think that there's already time travelers among us? Let me know in the comments below. Now, I'm going to go and take a dump in 1992. No, 1999.